Dear viewers, we thank you. We are back with the national agenda, and we thank you for keeping it on Urban TV. Mr. Muguzi, in the beginning, I talked about the outcry from the different stakeholders about government delays to reopen schools and other institutions of learning. What is your take on this outcry? Because from what I have gathered, from what happened in today's cabinet meeting, government is still hesitant to reopen these schools. And one of the arguments that came up in the cabinet meeting today was that that decision is based on the intention to protect the old people, who are estimated to be about 2 million old Ugandans who are 75 years and above, that when these young people go to schools, they can bring COVID to the old people, and the young people are not affected by COVID. What is your take on this matter?
Well, you see, Moses, I think, of course, now we do know that the government is working with scientists. We also do assume that the scientists are looking at what's happening. We also do know that everybody understands that COVID is a very reckless, ruthless, and very dangerous virus. We also do know that COVID is not going to go away. When viruses come, invade, and take territory, they never go away.
Except and also it's people, the compliance rate for the SOPs is below 5%,
now,
by the way.
I have said this. From the time we had a lockdown in Kampala, I went to Jinja, had my mask on. I looked out of place. Everybody did not have it. I kept fearing that an outbreak is going to happen. It never happened. I went to Chukuba one day. I passed in there. I wanted to put about 3 masks because of what I was seeing. I feared there's going to be an outbreak in Chukuba. Here it hasn't come. So to the ordinary Ugandan,
they are not bothered.
People do not understand. Now, you feel the pain of these young children who are not in school. It's now a year. The people who are elderly are 2 million. That percentage could be around 0 point something. Because you are 45 million, 42 million?
About 45.
Uh-huh. If you look at the number of people who have died so far of COVID, I think it's 308 or something.
Yes.
I was calculating here and it is 0.0009% of the population. The truth is this, that I think government needs to understand that we just have to learn to live with COVID, because COVID won't go away. There is an outcry out there. We do know that there are countries which had opened up schools and now closing them again. I think it's India or something. They're closing them again.
Even Britain.
I know that even Britain, yeah. I know that Kenyans have opened to schools full throttle, but I think it's important. And the other thing I should mention is this, that, you see, these children come from a community. In most of our villages, you find a closed community of the people that live in that community. If the community does not have the virus, and the children are going to the same schools in the same community and coming back to the same, I think we can. There can be some way of mitigating it. But also, we look at democracy goes with numbers. So the numbers of these children who are hurting and are tired of staying at home.
Some are getting pregnant.
Some
others are losing interest in education.
Those numbers are much bigger than the elderly. I should not sound as if I'm insensitive to the elderly people. Okay? But what I'm saying is that I think we need to seriously rethink. We need to rethink that these children, 12 months out of school is too much time. Some of them have even lost interest. We are going to lose a generation here.
And the other thing which I have heard from many other stakeholders is that we are likely to have a mass exodus of teachers leaving the teaching profession, especially those who are in private schools.
Because they have already left teaching.
For so long, they are not getting salaries.
They've left teaching. Now, let me tell you this. They've left teaching, and they're leaving teaching at a time when the education service delivery is also not at its best. Just a few months ago, I went to the school I went to in my village. It is called Kirinda Primary School. So at the time I was studying there, We had four classroom blocks. Now there is only one. We had six teachers' quarters. There is none. The school has 100 pupils. It's a UPE school. Now, of course, now teachers who are in that school have moved on. They may never come back. But also after they have moved on, it will be difficult for that school to attract new teachers. What I'm saying is that I think we need to think very deeply. I think the situation might be much bigger than we think. I also think we need to learn to live with the COVID. This virus is going to stay here.
Charity, the cabinet decision today was that their decision was to reopen for only the semi-candidate classes at the beginning of March. What is your take on this debate? Should they reopen for semi-candidate classes or for all classes?
Auntie,
what advice do you give to government?
The truth is, Moses, from a parent's perspective, we all want the schools to open and we want our children to go back to school because we have, for one full year, kept them. And it's not that we are tired of keeping them, at least I'm not tired of keeping my children. But because we also feel for them, we want them to gain education. And mine are going to school, mine are studying through Zoom. There are schools.
How many can afford that?
Exactly, that's where I was coming. Mm. I was coming.
But even on Zoom, how do you know the attention of children?
No, it is okay.
How effective is it?
It is very effective because this is what my mind do. They have lessons. We have a timetable. It is for a week. It starts Monday up to Saturday. Now, they study 1 hour. They give them a break for 1 hour. They study another hour. They give them a break for another hour, like that. So their full
day is spread. So how many hours a day?
So they are spread from I've said 8 a.m. to 6 p.m. So they start at 8 to 9, then they give them 1 hour's break. They go back at 10. 10 to 11, they give them an hour's break. Then they go back at 2. 2 to 3, they give them an hour's break. Then they go back at 4. 4 to 5, they give them an hour's break. That's it. Then the next day like that until Saturday. So it works for me. So about the Zoom classes, if they could increase for Kampala, it would have been okay. But remember, we have children in the rural areas.
In and my school, parents Chirinda,
who will not manage Zoom. Because even me, who is boasting about Zoom, I should tell you how much I am paying. But I will not say, I will not say the amount of money I am paying to get just one on Zoom.
Yeah,
it is extremely costly. Two on Zoom, I feel it in my pocket, but it's okay. The children are learning. So what do we want? I think that the government is at a crossroads. If you look at the UK, they had opened up for schools to start normally. And children, even in nursery schools, started to get COVID. UK was forced to close again. South Africa had opened up. Even Rwanda had opened. And they were forced to close again. So I think that government has been trying to move consciously. And parents have been careful. I mean, have been patient with government and its processes. The missing link for government has been and has always been, which kills me 100%, the lack of information to the stakeholders. Who are the parents? Who are the children? Why isn't the government on a continuous basis giving us a debrief of what it is they have agreed? They told us the other time it was the Minister of Education was coming up with the plans of how we could have them under big mango trees for different schools, such that because COVID does not stop places in air. Secondly, Ugandans have come up with hubs which are helping them treat COVID. You even had Dr. Musenero saying there are less cases coming to hospital because Ugandans have learned to treat themselves from home to treat that COVID. Can we explore the option of teaching the others who haven't learned those options, home remedies, which are working for others, to learn those home remedies? And we resume the school for all of us all. I mean, I'm giving options because now we need a solution. And then, most importantly of all, we need government to come out and tell us what were these plans which they came up with, short term, long term, so that we also advise our stakeholders what parents have. That's why we had PTAs, that parents would come out and give explanations. students can also give explanations. So opening for semi-candidate classes is good. But me, I think that even if my child was not in a semi-candidate class, I would like them to go to school.
But I'm sure you are aware that universities had actually notified students and parents who have students we call freshers, first-year
yes.
students.
Yes.
They were scheduled to commence
in January.
In February, I think, in February. And they had even issued them with letters and requirements, and some had even paid for hostel fees. What are they going to do?
Yes,
because the president is recently
remarks.
Edict was that they should wait until after 3 months.
Mm.
Yes.
Now, when the president came out and said we should wait until after 3 months, they did not break down for us what that means. Why was he saying we wait for 3 months? You remember the time when he used to come for the COVID talk on radio and TV? He used to tell us 21 days. We even had a song, 21 days, 21 days. We used to play that song, but he used to give an explanation. He would say, 21 more days, because my scientists have informed me of X, Y, and Z, and this is how we are going to open. We are going to open in phases.
Let's pick it from there. Let's go for a very brief commercial break. Our dear viewers, don't go away. We are coming back.